Hi, this is Ajay Anand and welcome to Science Classes from ExcelUp.com. In this lesson, you will learn about animal tissues. And this lesson has been taken from the chapter Tissue from Class 9th Science. So in a previous video, I talked about plant tissues and now this is all about animal tissue. Animal tissues are of four types, and they are epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscle tissue, and nervous tissue. Let us begin with epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue, it forms the covering or lining of organs, and cells of epithelial tissues, they are tightly packed. The epithelial tissue form a continuous sheet and it is separated by the underlying tissue by an extracellular fibrous basement membrane. There are four types of epithelial tissue: simple epithelium, cuboidal epithelium, columnar epithelium, and stratified squamous epithelium. So let us try to understand about them one by one. So number one is simple epithelium. So in case of simple epithelium, this is the basement membrane and there is a single layer of cell. So there is a thin layer. Simple epithelium, it is found in the lining of blood vessels, in the lining of alveoli, in the lining of buccal cavity also. Okay, so simple epithelium, it facilitates exchange of substances also. So there can be transportation of some materials. So for example, certain medicines, they are easily absorbed when they are kept sublingually, that is below the tongue. Okay, now second one is cuboidal epithelium. In this case, this is the basement membrane and these are the cells. Cells are cuboidal in shape, and that's why the name cuboidal epithelium has been given. Cuboidal epithelium is found in kidney tubules and in ducts of salivary glands. In some cases, some cells of the cuboidal epithelium, they acquire secretory role, that means they secrete certain substances, and in that case this tissue is called glandular epithelium. So such a tissue will be found in endocrine glands like pancreas or adrenal glands, etc. The third one is columnar epithelium. In this case, the cells are in the form of long columns. So you can see these columns. This is the basement membrane. Columnar epithelium is found in lining of intestine. Sometimes there can be cilia present on inside the columnar epithelium. Cilia are fine hair-like structures. So for example, in case of bronchioles, there are ciliated epithelium. So the cilia, they move in order to expel out mucus and other debris also. Ciliated epithelium is also found in ovary. So that the movement can facilitate the transfer of egg from ovary to fallopian tubes. Then this is the stratified squamous epithelium. So in this case, there are numerous layers of cell. So these are the layers. And because of these layers or strata, this is called stratified squamous epithelium. Stratified squamous epithelium is present in skin, and so many layers, they prevent wear and tear of skin. That is the advantage. Now the second type is connective tissue. The connective tissue, it supports, protects, and gives structure to other organs and tissues, and that is why this is called connective tissue. Cells of connective tissue, they are loosely scattered in a matrix. Matrix is a base. So for example, you can take the example of a curry. So if the gravy is the matrix, then vegetables are like cells. You can also take the example of a pizza. So the pizza base is the matrix and the toppings, they are like cells. So similarly, in case of connective tissue, the matrix can be in liquid form, it can be solid, or it can be jelly-like also. So there are five types of connective tissue. One is called areolar connective tissue. Number two is adipose tissue. Then number three is bone. Number fourth is cartilage. And number five is blood. Let us begin with areolar connective tissue. Areolar connective tissue, it fills the gap between tissues and provides support to organs. So, for example, it is found between skin and muscles, it is found around blood vessels and nerves, it is found in bone marrow, it also helps in repair. This diagram, it shows areolar connective tissue. So, this appears to be quite complicated. So, the background is matrix and these are different types of components. So, these are fibroblasts, these are collagen fibers, okay. These are macrophage, these are plasma cells. So you can see that the components, they are not densely packed, they are loosely packed. Now this is adipose tissue. Adipose tissue is composed of fat globules. You can also call them fat tissue. This is found below skin and beneath the organs, provides insulation and cushion. So this is the structure, these are fat globules and this is the surrounding matrix. So fat is found everywhere below the skin, and because of its tendency to deposit below the skin, people get belly fat, they get huge bellies. Blood is a liquid tissue, it is a connective tissue, and this is composed of plasma, RBCs, WBCs and platelets. Plasma is the matrix and these are the cells. So RBC stands for red blood cells or red blood corpuscles. This is disc-like in shape and this is concave. Because of its concave shape and disc shape, RBCs, they can easily pass through the narrowest capillaries. The function of RBC is to carry oxygen. RBC is red in color because of presence of hemoglobin. WBCs, they are of irregular shape and their job is to fight with diseases. Platelets, they are small dot-like structures and the role of platelet is blood coagulation or blood clotting. So what happens whenever someone gets an injury or a cut, the blood starts oozing out and after some time, say for around 1 or 2 minutes, the blood clots at the site of injury. So this is a defense mechanism which prevents excess loss of blood. Otherwise, what will happen if the excessive blood loss is there, it can result in serious condition or it can even result in death of the patient. Bone is a hard tissue and this is mainly composed of osteoblasts. Osteoblasts, they are the cells of the bone tissue. And the matrix of the bone is composed of calcium and phosphorus. So bone forms the main skeleton, like the bones of hands, ribcage, vertebral column, skull, etc. These are made up of bones. Cartilage is elastic and softer than bone. The cells in cartilage, they are loosely packed compared to bone. And the cells are called chondrioblasts or chondrioblasts. Okay. Then there are two important connective tissue related to the musculoskeletal system. They are called ligament and tendon. Let us focus on this diagram. This is a joint, this is a knee joint. These are bones, this is the kneecap, and this is cartilage, the shaded portion. okay. Number one is bone, number two is cartilage, number four is muscle, number three is ligament. Ligament is the tissue which connects a bone to another bone. Ligament is strong and elastic, and tendon is a tissue which connects a bone to a muscle. Tendon is also strong, but it is less flexible compared to ligament. Now there can be confusion how to remember the names ligament and tendon, and how to correlate them, whether ligament is connected to bone or whether tendon is connected to muscle. So an easier way to remember this is that alphabetically the bone will come earlier than muscle in a dictionary, because B comes before M. Now ligament, L comes before T. So ligament will come earlier than tendon in a dictionary. So by this correlation, you can easily remember that ligament connects a bone to a bone, while tendon connects a bone to a muscle. Okay. Now comes the muscle tissue. Muscle tissues, they are responsible for facilitating movement in organs. Muscle tissues, they work like strings of a puppeteer. So for example, this is a puppet and these are the string. So what happens when the puppeteer, he manipulates the string, the puppet will dance or move to the tune of the puppeteer, and that is how muscles work. So for example, when these muscles, this muscle, it pulls, then there will be movement in leg. Okay. There are three types of muscle tissues: striated muscle, smooth muscle, and cardiac muscle. Okay. In case of striated muscle, the cells, they are in the form of long fibers and they are multinucleate, which means they have more than one nucleus. There are alternate light and dark bands appearing on striated muscle fibers, and these bands, they are called striations. Striated muscles control the movement of voluntary organs, that is movements which are under our conscious control. Smooth muscles, they have spindle shaped cells. So these cells, they are pointed at ends and wide at the middle. Okay. So smooth muscles, they control involuntary movements, movements which are not under our conscious control. So for example, movement of intestine or movement of many other internal organs, they are under the control of smooth muscle. Cardiac muscle is more or less similar to striated muscle. The only difference is that striated muscles, they are not branched, but cardiac muscles, they are branched. Then another difference is the cells of cardiac muscles, they have single nucleus. Striations are present as in case of these muscles, and cardiac muscles, they are found in heart. So striated muscles, they easily get tired after a few rounds of contraction and relaxation. So for example, if you have to run for say half a kilometer or 200 meter, you can easily get tired because your muscles get tired. But cardiac muscles, they never get tired. They keep on contracting and dilating throughout the life, and that is why the heart keeps on beating and pumping blood throughout the life. Okay. So now let us see how does contraction of muscles work. So a muscle has two types of fiber. Okay. One is called actin fiber and another is called myosin fiber. So these are actin fibers and these are myosin fiber. Muscles have small channels and they are called calcium channels. So once calcium enters the channel, calcium channels, what happens, the fibers, they slide towards each other. So what will happen, this is actin and this myosin will slide, okay, there will be less gap, and as a result there will be contraction of muscle. Once calcium exits the calcium channel, then the actin and myosin, they move away from each other, and then the muscle gets relaxed. And the last one is nervous tissue. Nervous tissue, it receives and transmits nerve impulses, okay, and this makes the nervous system. The functional unit of nervous tissue or nervous system is neuron. This is a neuron. A neuron, it appears like a star with a long tail, okay. So this head is called cyton or cell body, and the tail is called axon. There are many hair like growths on cyton, and these are called dendrites. At the end of the axon there are some growths, and these are called axon terminals. There is a covering around the tail, and this covering is called myelin sheath. It provides insulation against electrical impulses of the surrounding. It works in the same way as plastic casing on electric wire works, okay. Now these arrows, they show the direction of transmission of nerve signals. So it happens from dendrite to axon terminals. So what happens, whenever a nerve signal comes, these dendrites, they work like receivers of antenna. They catch the signals and they transmit the neurotransmitter through the tail or axon of the neuron, and once it reaches axon terminal, it is released so that it can be received by dendrite of next neuron, and that is how electrical signals or nerve signals, they travel from one neuron to another neuron. Let us recapitulate. I talked about the various types of animal tissue, like epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscle tissue, and nervous tissue. That's all for this lesson. Thank you.